literacy and mutual respect for others. In addition, Khalil offers pastoral care to all students and communities across campus and often lectures on Islam and multi-faith engagement. Professionally, he has held various leadership and management roles, taught in public and private schools, designed Islamic studies syllabi, and organized teacher and chaplaincy trainings. He has been active in interfaith dialogue, minority male mentoring, and social justice efforts, while also serving as imam in mosques in Georgia, South Carolina, and Texas. Khalil is completing a master's degree in religious studies at Hartford Seminary, where he also worked as its major gifts officer. He also worked, his interests include Muslim-Christian relations, religious ethics, and the history of Islam in America, and with a focus on the African-American Muslim experience. And one last thing I'll say, I'm saying this with my love, and I know he's not just a scholar and a servant of the community, he's very humble. He's one of those people that would take their shirts off their back, and I know that this won't make his head, you know, won't swell his head. But one of the things that was said to me by one of the elders in Atlanta, Georgia, one of the elders, one of the older brothers, he said, "No one in this city knows the language and the tafsir of Imam Waqidi Muhammad like Imam Khalil Abdullah." Even though it's not here in his bio, he had the blessing of sitting under and studying with Imam Waqidi Muhammad Ramatullah in Chicago before he passed in 2008 for many, many years. And so you're going to be hearing not just, you know, the words of someone who's read a lot about Imam Waqidi Muhammad, but someone who's traveled with him, someone who's sat with him, who's asked him questions, and has had the benefit of his companionship. Jazakallah khairan, I leave you with Imam Khalil Abdullah.
Assalamu alaikum. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Wassalatu Wassalamu ala Rasulihi al-Kareem. It is indeed an honor and a pleasure to be in this wonderful space, the space that really speaks to God's majesty and to His beauty. And I am deeply grateful for my dear friend and teacher and mentor and imam and homie, my homeboy from the ATL
and
from Texas, Sheikh Mendes. You all, as you know, my father would say I'm preaching to the choir right now, but as you all know, you're very blessed to have him. You all have not even had him long enough to really, really know how fortunate you are. So I'm praying for you all, and I'm praying for him and for your success together, inshallah. It's late. I don't want to be too long. What I do want to spend some time doing is sharing very briefly the life and legacy of Imam W.D. Muhammad. How many, just by a quick show of hands, know W.D. Muhammad or have heard of W.D. Muhammad? So maybe about half. So we've titled this brief presentation, The Mosque Cares. The Mosque Cares was The name that W.D. Muhammad gave to his ministry in the last few years of his life. He passed away in 2008, and the mosque cares was very intentional in its language and in its message to the mind and to the spirit of Muslims and to non-Muslims, to send the message that the mosque cares, that the mosque cares. I'm going to start out by asking you to read, and we'll read together, a quote from W.E.B. Du Bois. Show of hands, anyone know W.E.B. Du Bois? W.E.B. Du Bois was one of the giants in the black intellectual life of the late 19th century and early 20th century. He's considered a scholar of sociology, particularly black sociology, black spirituality, religious studies. And often in W.D. Muhammad's conversations and in his public lectures, he would mention a number of African-American leaders, prominent figures in our history. And one of them was W.E.B. Du Bois. And Du Bois had a concept of double consciousness. And I want to read now something very short from a much longer, much broader discourse on this concept. It is a peculiar sensation, this double consciousness, this sense of always looking at oneself through the eyes of others, of measuring one's soul by the tape of a world that looks on in amused contempt and pity. One ever feels his two-ness, an American, a Negro. Maybe we can say an American, South Asian, an American, Arab. One ever feels his or her two-ness, an American, a Negro. Two souls, two thoughts, two unreconciled strivings, two warring ideals in one dark body whose dogged strength alone keeps it from being torn asunder. When I think of the legacy of W.D. Muhammad, I think of many words, but one in particular, reconciliation. Reconciliation. To reconcile what seems to be two, as Du Bois describes it, souls, two thoughts, two strivings in the body and the soul of the human person. Du Bois was describing this in 1903 about what African Americans, what black Americans were feeling on the inside. It was in the most, what scholars call, the darkest days of African American history. The term N-A-D-I-R, Nadir, or Nadir, this dark, deep point, post-Civil War. You had Jim Crow, and you had different laws that were burdening the soul of African Americans, burdening their life. And I'm mentioning this because I think that this is something, while Du Bois is speaking about African Americans in the early 20th century, should resonate a bit with us as Muslims, as we tend to struggle with identity. We live in a world where we can somewhat create ourselves We can kind of manufacture who we are, right? And we're many things. We're not just Muslim, right? We're also South Asian, and Arab, and Black, and White, right? And Latino, right? We're many things, right? We're professionals, right? We're husbands and wives. We're many things. We're not just one thing. So we have a number of identities, multiple identities. And Du Bois's words register deep in my soul, because I know, as he says, it's a peculiar sensation. It's a sensation that feels like I should be able to change it. It's a burden, sometimes not comfortable, but I'm always pushed to strive to make it what the biblical language, what scriptural language says, a sense of wholeness, to feel whole. To feel whole, to not feel like we're being torn in different directions, that I have to be this or I have to be that, but that we can be all of the components of who we are in a whole, in a unity, okay? Does that make sense? Some of you may have felt this. Some of you may have felt this kind of cool. Can I be Muslim and American? Can I be Muslim and Black? Can I be American and South Asian? And Muslim at the same time? So this is what Du Bois is touching on. What he's bringing out for us. And I wanted to share that because I find it resonates with the life of our community. So, in W.D. Muhammad's work, in his life and in his legacy, I find among all of his accomplishments that his ability to reconcile the human life with all of its identities and all of its urgings and all of its desires to feel whole in this space is one of his greatest achievements. So if I had a board, I would write legacy, reconciliation. Or if you're taking notes, legacy, reconciliation. So we can't talk about W.D. Muhammad without talking about his mother and his father. W.D. Muhammad was born in 1933. W.D. Muhammad. He was born in Michigan in the 1930s. Where life for African Americans was difficult, was burdensome. Not only for African Americans, in the 30s, we had the Great Depression, and then we had difficult times for people in America. The racism was prevalent. The othering of blacks was prevalent. And W.D. Muhammad was born into a black Muslim family. He's the son of Elijah Muhammad, the founder of the Nation of Islam. And we don't have enough time to really unpack what the Nation of Islam means and its significance, not just to African American Muslims, but to all of us sitting in the room. Not its theological differences that we may have, but its social impact, its value on bringing Islam into the public discourse. The Nation of Islam is in many ways responsible for allowing Islam to begin to flourish in America. His mother, Clara Muhammad, and I want you to see the picture, because I think the picture speaks volumes about her strength, about the beauty of a Muslim woman. His father, Elijah Muhammad, the founder of the Nation of Islam. I put this picture up. There's a number of pictures that one could look on the internet and find, but I thought it was quite telling. It speaks a great deal to this term of signification. Signification. S-I-G-N-I-F-I. It's a long word to spell. C-A-T-I-O-N. Comes from signify, right? Signification in Professor Charles Long's work means naming and identifying, to put it briefly. To name and identify something, it's a process. So in the 1930s, blacks were called niggas. All kinds of ugly names. Negro, a number of. But signification means that one can give themselves a name. They can name themselves. So many African Americans did that in becoming Muslim and dropping their name of what we would say was the name of the slave master, the name given to us over many generations. And we took on our own names. Most of us know Malcolm X, right? He took the name, last name X, right? X. Very significant in that it's saying, I don't quite know my true identity. But my identity isn't the last name of those who owned my parents or my grandparents or my great-great-grandparents. So I'm going to take the power into my own hands and I'm going to name myself. This is extremely important, to be able to have a good name. In the Hebrew Bible, it says that a good name is better than gold. A good name is better than gold. And we know that in the Quran, we have a picture of Adam. And Allah says, "Allama Adama asma'a kulla," that He taught the names of all things to Adam. That He taught Adam the names of things. So we get a sense that names are important. That naming is meaning. So, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, I put this picture up because I want you to look at it, and there's a lot to take away. One, he's holding the Quran. He's holding the Quran. So, the Quran was always important, even back in the 1920s and 30s, to this community, to the African-American community, and in particular the Nation of Islam that I'm speaking of now. But he also has a fez, right? Like he's in Morocco, right? This really, then he has a star and a crescent, right? Like it's Turkey, right? There's a lot of identities here, right? He has a bow tie on that looks like the normal American banker, but he's holding the Quran. This is such a wonderful picture. We can unpack this picture for a long time, for all of these multiple identities, all of these significations that are going on in this one picture. So, W.D. Muhammad is born to this community of Elijah Muhammad and Clara Muhammad. And this picture is a very famous picture taken by a very famous black photographer named Gordon Parks. Gordon Parks. He documented for many, many decades black life in America. And this picture has Elijah Muhammad sitting down. And you can see now he has a different kufi. And this kufi is the one that you typically see, where he has a star, embroidered star and crescent, and it says the messenger on it. And then you have his son, a late 20, maybe 30-something year old, I would say more in the 20s, holding a big Quran. That's a big Quran, right? But it's sending a message, it's saying something in this picture. And behind him is a framed picture of Elijah Muhammad's teacher, W.D. Farrar. And we know that the Nation of Islam, at least the rhetoric, most of the language around the Nation of Islam, is that the Nation of Islam was a black separatist movement. That the language and rhetoric was racialized. The black man was God, and the white man was the devil. Maybe some of you all have heard this language. What's interesting is when you look at the picture, you don't see a black man in the frame picture behind you, or behind you. Right? You see someone who looks white. Most of the history tellers say that he was South Asian. That the founder of the Nation of Islam was South Asian. That's like a mic drop, right? I can just leave now. Oh! There's a mystery around this man. He was only with his student, Elijah Muhammad, for about 3 years. It said that he appeared in Detroit on July 4th, 1930. On Independence Day, 1930, he appeared. And he began to teach in small groups in people's homes, certain themes about Islam. And the language was there. And he had some magic tricks, right, to convince those that were gathered to hear him of his authenticity, right, of his uniqueness, that he was special. W.D. Farrar. Again, each picture we could unpack, but I just want to kind of walk us through and give you a sense of W.D. Muhammad. His life, people that were important to him, his work, how all of this goes into this idea of reconciliation. Again, you see in the picture behind me, the picture behind them, a picture of W.D. Farrar, who taught Elijah Muhammad, who then taught his son and so many other black men and women who had entered into the Nation of Islam, both of them holding the Quran. So the Quran was always something of value in this community. Always something of value to W.D. Muhammad. Always. Now, I have this picture up here because it was mainly South Asians who brought Islam to the African American community. Back in the, again, late 1800s, early 1900s, all the way through the 20s, and the 30s, you had missionaries coming from India. Many of them in the Ahmadiyya, from the Ahmadiyya Lahore movement. And they had a strong appetite for missionary work in America. Initially, their hope was to go into white communities, right, the power structure, and convince them about the truth of Islam. They didn't have much success in those communities in the early 1900s. So they turned to the African American communities and found great acceptance in those communities. They took the Quran into the African American community. They took the life of the Prophet into the African American community. And it began to resonate with them. I'm putting this picture up of Muhammad Siddiq because he is considered one of the early missionaries in American Islam. Okay? Abdullah Yusuf Ali. Has anyone ever read a Quran translated by Yusuf Ali? Well, this is what he looks like. This is who's translated the Quran. It's a Quran that really again comes out of the South Asian ethos and worldview. When I say South Asian, I'm also want us to kind of think about British colonialism, right? And what that did to the spirit of the people in India. So you can begin to see the connection between their work and their mission in America was really prompted by white racism in India. And so that language was very transferable to African Americans who were also suffering under white racism. So there's a relationship that's very long with African American Muslims and South Asians. I think that's really important, not only for tonight, but moving forward. It's really important to do a better job of cultivating that particular relationship. Now, many of us have read Yusuf Ali and his translation, but the most popular translation of the Quran early on in the Nation of Islam was done by another Ahmadiyya missionary named Maulana Muhammad Ali. Some of you have read his translation, or you can get it in any bookstore. So we won't spend much time on that, but I wanted to give a little bit of a history lesson in connecting the work of these missionaries from South Asia who were shaped and formed under British colonialism and why perhaps their work and their success within the African American community makes so much sense. Okay. So now we have what most of us are familiar with, and that is Malcolm X. But I put this picture here of Malcolm because I want you to see him with W.B. Muhammad. Oftentimes, we think of Malcolm as kind of the face of the Nation of Islam, and in many ways, he was. He was, if not the face, he was certainly the voice. Honorable Elijah Muhammad was always the biggest influence even on Malcolm's life. And if you study Malcolm, you'll see Malcolm says that often, that Elijah Muhammad was the biggest influence on him to create the man that he became. Not necessarily intellectually or from a theological perspective, but what he did for him socially, helping him begin to reconcile with himself his true identity. That's Elijah Muhammad and the work of the Nation of Islam. But Wallace, at that time, W.B. Muhammad, Wallace Muhammad, was also a minister like Malcolm in the Nation of Islam. And anyone ever read the autobiography of Malcolm X? Transformative book. Very powerful, written by Alex Haley. And if you go back, if any of you have it, if you go to the library, you can find it, and you'll look in the index, and you'll see the reference to Wallace Muhammad. And you'll see that Malcolm, at least twice, if not maybe three times, says of Wallace, it is really Wallace who's the most spiritual, the most gifted, the most perceptive of Elijah's sons. It's really Wallace who was my mentor and my teacher. And I'm putting this up because this is right before Malcolm on stage is getting ready to address the community. And you see behind him the women, the Muslim women dressed in their white, right? And he's looking into the Quran, and Wallace is just leaning over, listening to what Malcolm is saying, or perhaps what Malcolm is asking. This is a really powerful picture because it really speaks truth. Wallace was an important figure in the Nation of Islam and an important figure in the life of Malcolm, evolving into the Muslim that we now know as Al-Hajj Malik El-Shabazz. I mentioned last night in my talk at Princeton that oftentimes when we read the autobiography of Malcolm, we are kind of under the impression, I think Alex Haley, as a professional writer, does a really great job, right? Making us feel, giving us a sense that it was the Hajj that made Malcolm's eyes open to the equality of human beings. That it was the Hajj that allowed him to see, oh, white, blue-eyed, blonde-haired men and women aren't devils. They can be Muslim too. I would propose that it perhaps wasn't the Hajj that revealed that to Malcolm, but his relationship ongoing, his dialogue and his discussions and his study with Wallace Muhammad that opened him up to the Quran and opened him up to new conversations about what Islam means. And so when he went on Hajj, it was more of an affirmation than an epiphany. That's my own personal opinion. Okay? And an opinion I think is somewhat informed by pioneers that I've had an opportunity to speak to and discuss the relationship with Wallace and Malcolm. And we have some pioneers in the room. I'm looking around, and there are a few here who could perhaps add to that as we get to our questions. So here's the Nation of Islam, quickly. I just want to show this picture. You have a picture, and in the back there's a banner that says, "There is no God but Allah." This is in the 50s. In the 30s was the beginning of the Nation of Islam. In the 30s and the 40s, it was relatively a small movement. It was a relatively quiet movement. Wasn't as political, more spiritual and religious. But in the 50s, the nature of the Nation of Islam began to change. It had a strong prison ministry. And we know that it was in prison that Malcolm became Muslim. And when Malcolm came out of prison, he really became the voice of the Nation of Islam. And so here we have a picture of Malcolm speaking, and if you notice, I should stand up and point this out. There's a young Louis Farrakhan. Elijah Muhammad. Minister James Shabazz, who was one of the leading figures in the Nation of Islam. He was the tough man. He was the guy you didn't want to meet. And then you
I was gonna say you could take the
mic. Okay. I'll try to speak up. I'm gonna sit back down. And then you see his mother, and then you see a young Wallace. Just a picture of the Nation of Islam, just to give you a sense of the intellectual prowess on this stage, the power on this stage. we know that in just, I want to make this point, because it'll be important for me as we get to the end here. In the late 50s, right around this time, a young Wallace Muhammad was the minister at the temple, Muhammad's Mosque in Philadelphia. He was there for only a few years because in 1961 he refused to go into the draft. He refused to work to go into the military. Okay? And one of the reasons that he did that was because no one in the Nation of Islam was allowed to go into the military. It wasn't something that the Nation of Islam encouraged or promoted. In fact, we know even into the 60s, the great Muhammad Ali lost his belt because he refused to go into the draft and fight in the Vietnam War. Right? So the Nation of Islam had a very long history of not going into the military, right? For many reasons. Even the Honorable Elijah Muhammad himself spent time in prison because of that, okay? In 1963, Wallace Muhammad was released from prison. A year later, Malcolm is assassinated. 4 years later, Martin Luther King Jr. is assassinated. Elijah Muhammad is still living and doesn't pass until 1975. Okay. In 1975, a young Wallace Muhammad, young, becomes the leader of the Nation of Islam. The Nation of Islam at this time in 1975 is one of the most powerful black organizations in America. Not considered that only by black Muslims or African American Muslims, but by black America, by white America. It's a powerful organization, a powerful movement. It's used against the civil rights movement. So the civil rights movement and Martin Luther King, and then it's Malcolm and the Nation of Islam and on one side or the other. Right? A very, very powerful movement. And in 1975, Jet Magazine. Anyone know Jet Magazine? Jet Magazine, it's an African American publication, like Ebony. It's a small magazine. And I think it was weekly at one point. And you'll see at the very top, it says, "New Muslim leader charts interracial future of his nation." So the discourse on W.D. Muhammad was really that he was a person to reconcile the races. He was a person who was going to now take this black separatist Muslim movement and bring it into orthodoxy. To bring it into orthodoxy. To bring it into the Ummah of Muhammad. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So from 1975, W.D. Muhammad is somewhat charged with this work to bring in or to diversify the organization, the Nation of Islam. Right? At this time, he's called W.D. Muhammad, the Supreme Minister. The Supreme Minister of the Nation of Islam. Now, I mentioned the word signification because we have an organization called the Nation of Islam, which will change over time. And we also have W.D. Muhammad beginning to signify or change his name to reveal new meaning, to reveal new meaning for the African American Muslim. So he's called Supreme Minister at this time. Not long after 75, he began to implement changes to the Nation of Islam. At one point, the Nation of Islam drew a great deal from its Christian brothers and sisters in terms of services. There were chairs in the mosque. We didn't sit on the floors. The American flag was not hung up inside or outside, but was not accepted. The Nation of Islam had their own flag, still has their own flag, right? That has a star and a crescent, red with a white star and a crescent, and in the corners, in four corners, there's F for freedom, in another corner, there's J for justice, in another corner, there's E for equality, and then another corner, there's I for Islam. Freedom, justice, and equality. So the Nation of Islam definitely had it right. That's what Islam is. Freedom, justice, and equality. We see now this reconciliation happening. One, W.D. Muhammad is thrust into the position of reconciling the races, the racial makeup of the Nation of Islam. So maybe there were some whites. I don't think that there were many whites coming into the Nation of Islam. They still might not have felt quite as comfortable as they maybe do now back in 1975 in that space. But the language changed. The white devil wasn't the body anymore. It wasn't the physical makeup of a person, it was their mind. It was their mind. And W.D. Muhammad said, anyone can take on that mind. You don't have to be white, you can be black, you can be brown, you can be yellow. That anyone can take on the mind of the oppressor. And so right away, through language, you begin to work on its members, okay? I put this picture up because to go from the Nation of Islam, who didn't accept the American flag and what it stood for, to just a few years later, W.D. Muhammad picking up the flag and saying to the community, if you won't pick it up, I will. And this picture reminds me, it's like he's on the moon. Right? He's not like he's pledging allegiance to it, right? He's holding it like he's Neil Armstrong. I can't remember exactly who it was that set it down and you know, one. Who? Yes.
Edwin Aldrin and Neil Armstrong.
Okay. He's getting ready to plant it, right? Like he's like on the moon, but he's in a mosque, right? What's the saying? One small step for man, one giant leap for mankind, right? So I like to say that this was one small step for man, one giant leap for the Nation of Islam. One giant leap for black Muslims in America. Right? And for many of us in this room, for many, many decades, I would argue perhaps many of us, just until the last 10 years, it was a giant leap for us. Why? Because we had what Du Bois said, this double consciousness, right? I'm trying to be American and Muslim at the same time. How can I do that? And I'm saying that W.D. Muhammad, through language and through his work and his legacy, is that he allowed his community, his followers, to comfortably find wholeness and feel that we can be all of these things and not compromise who we really are. Another picture of W.D. Muhammad, one that I just particularly like. At one point, he was Supreme Minister of the Nation of Islam. And then he changed his name. He was W.D. Muhammad, Spokesman for Human Salvation. That's a big title to give oneself. Spokesman for Human Salvation. But what he was doing was also introducing the language of human. At first, we were, black man was God, right? And the white man was the devil in the Nation of Islam. And then, we were Muslim, black Muslims, African Americans. But he also was saying to us, more than any of that, you're human. You're a human being. And he was working on us to help us understand, what does it mean to be a human being? What does it mean to be a black man? What does it mean to be a black woman? What does it mean to be South Asian or Arab? But that, along with my humanity, and how do I live comfortably with both? Which one takes precedence over the other? And that begins to work and shape on the human being, but also begins to determine the human person's relationship with others. And so W.D. Muhammad was doing all of this. So I mentioned the term signification before I move on to Nelson Mandela and some of the work that W.D. Muhammad did. I'm not going to take too much longer. But this is maybe some more notes. The Nation of Islam eventually became, if we were to go back and look at this picture, the World Community of Islam in the West. World Community of Islam in the West. Yeah, that's a lot, saying a lot. We go from the Nation of Islam to now, we see ourselves as part of the world community of Islam, but in the West. All of this is very relevant for us as we try to navigate our identities, negotiate who we are, right? What Islam feels like home, but what it feels like also here in this home. And how do we reconcile the two? How do I practice Islam in home, in the way that I was accustomed to, what my legacy and history and culture and tradition says? But now, how do I practice Islam in Windsor? West Windsor? Is this West Windsor? Windsor. In West Windsor. Because I have to practice it perhaps in different ways. It may take different nuances and different shapes than it did in Pakistan, or Bangladesh, right? Or Saudi, in India, in Ghana, in Nigeria. So, world community of Islam, we're part of the global ummah, but we're in the West. So W.D. Muhammad was working on his community to begin to think about identity. And this is part of signification, naming and identifying. We went then from World Community of Islam in the West to the American Muslim Mission. We had a lot of names, but it was purposeful. It was deliberate, because W.D. Muhammad's life and his legacy was moving us in a direction of wholeness. To not feel, as Du Bois says, that we're being pulled in different directions, that there are two strivings that we're having a difficult time reconciling. American Muslim Mission. And then from there, we became the Muslim American Society. Muslim American Society. And then that changed slightly, because there was another group who had a very similar name, if not maybe the same name, Muslim American Society. It changed to American Muslim Society. That, from what I understand, was the last of the naming, of the signification of a community. And then W.D. Muhammad named his own ministry for the work that he wanted to do and wanted his community to follow. He called his ministry the Mosque Cares. The Mosque Cares. So very, very quickly, W.D. Muhammad went from the Nation of Islam to becoming the leader of the Nation of Islam. And did so in the 50s, in the 60s, in the 70s, in the 80s. In the 80s, he spent a great deal of time reconciling us, the world community of Islam in the West, with the Muslim world. And so there was a tremendous amount of travel, a tremendous amount of relationship building across the Muslim world with the former Nation of Islam. So again, he's reconciling ourselves, who we are as Black Muslims or African American Muslims, with our brothers and sisters all over the Muslim world. Very important part of his work. But he also didn't want us to forget our connection not only to Africa, but to the freedom fighters, the freedom movements happening in Africa. And so Nelson Mandela and he were dear friends. They shared a similar mind, similar ideas, similar interests and desires to see their people free. See their people not only free, but self-actualizing, right? See them institution building, to see them take control of their lives so that they can have their own significant voice in the world. Okay. Again, I talked about the Muslim world and that reconciliation. I show this because I think it's important to know that in all of the pictures I could show with W.D. Muhammad and leaders around the Muslim world, I thought this was telling and important because you see Arafat, and it brings obviously to mind the Palestinian life. And for me, it's important to say that W.D. Muhammad was a supporter of the Palestinians, and that he was a supporter, obviously. How can you not be when you come from the Nation of Islam and you come from a language where your language is speaking against oppression? He didn't want his community to lose that interest, that we could fight the good fight here. But if we're fighting the good fight here, we also have to support the good fight with our brothers and sisters around the Muslim world. Reconciling our community with our brothers and sisters around the world. I put this up here because, one, I like this picture and I think it speaks a great deal to the work that happens in America. The work that W.D. Muhammad did, Parvez Ahmed is there, and Rahab, and others, Islamic Society of North America, in this constant effort, which I alluded to earlier, of bringing together African American Muslims with South Asians. Or with, and I say South Asian because ISNA and IGNA as well, right, have been leading those efforts for a long time. And W.D. Muhammad knew of the important relationship that needed to be formed and solidified between these communities. I hope, inshallah, and I pray that despite his passing in 2008, and despite not having perhaps a central voice for W.D. Muhammad, that we don't allow that to interfere and impede the relationship building that we still must do across racial and cultural lines. W.D. Muhammad wanted us to reconcile ourselves with each other. I have here the Focolare movement. Anyone familiar with the Focolare movement? The Focolare movement is a movement started by a Catholic woman, Chiara Lubich. She's an illuminary. She's passed away, but she was a light in the world. She had a following, very much like W.D. Muhammad, not quite as big, but she had a following, and her followers, Christian, Catholic. She was in Rome, in Italy, but she was a voice for compassion and a voice for racial reconciliation, religious reconciliation. W.D. Muhammad formed a relationship with her and her community and encouraged his community to strengthen their bonds. Quite interesting when you look at what's happening here. The Nation of Islam, right, is now forming relationships across the world, right, across racial lines, across religious lines. For us, certainly for African Americans, interfaith dialogue, interfaith dialogue has become quite popular now, right? It's a movement within itself, right? It for many of those who were in the civil rights movement, it's the next bus to get on, right? We got off the civil rights and we jumped on the interfaith movement bus, right? For African Americans, I argue that it's not simply interfaith dialogue where we're learning about each other's faith traditions and what we have in common, right? For African Americans, it's more than that. It's cultural politics. It opens up doors for us that perhaps would not have been open. And so interfaith dialogue is serving the African American community in particular in very unique ways that while we can have a conversation about religion, underneath, there's this conversation going on about race, very quietly about race. I mentioned Chiara Lubich and the Focolare movement because when W.D. Muhammad was asked, why this relationship? He said, because she and her followers can teach us how to love one another. How to love one another. That he saw in her and her movement true expression of love. And he wanted us, in developing a relationship with her and her movement, her followers, to learn how to love each other better. I put this picture up because, again, interfaith dialogue, Pope John Paul II, back in 1999, W.D. Muhammad was invited to the Vatican to give an address to hundreds of thousands of people in St. Peter's Square there at the Vatican. Very important, very, very celebratory moment that the son of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, a man with a third grade education from Georgia, would at some point be an invited guest of the Pope and the Vatican to speak about race, to speak about religion, and to speak about reconciliation. It's a really powerful, powerful moment. And it shows us the power of Allah, the wisdom of God. So his legacy is a legacy of race reconciliation. His legacy is a legacy of religious reconciliation, reconciling religions through interfaith dialogue, reconciling the races through conversation, right, through healthy dialogue. Another one of his legacies is education. Sheikh Mendes knows well W.D. Muhammad High School because he taught there. And I taught there as well, and there's nothing more precious to the community of W.D. Muhammad than education. Many, many schools around the country. This particular school, W.D. Muhammad High School, is in Atlanta. produced incredible, incredible students. They're all over, professors, and just a really wonderful place. I put this up because, again, another legacy of W.D. Muhammad is education, Muslim education. So as we begin to start all of our schools, and we begin to see all of the Muslim schools developing around the country, know that decades and decades before we begin to see that happen, W.D. Muhammad and his community were opening up schools. Right? Before W.D. Muhammad High School, we had Clara Muhammad, right? Clara Muhammad School, right? Right? And many of you may know that we have them all over the country. So Clara Muhammad was named after his mother. So again, that's why I showed the picture earlier, because we can't disconnect the two. Right? Her legacy, right, is education. And he always wanted us to be mindful of that. So here's a picture. We have a picture of the graduating high school class in their regalia. We have La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah above it. Really wonderful. Another reconciliation is that, remember Honorable Elijah Muhammad and his son Wallace Muhammad, Muhammad Ali, they refused to go into the military. But at some point, W.D. Muhammad, through his language, through his efforts to reconcile us, to feel comfortable and whole in who we are as Muslims and Americans. It's a really powerful picture that decades later, they can be invited to the Pentagon, and W.D. Muhammad can be the invited guest to give a lecture at the Pentagon, right? And stand with members that are black Muslims in the military. And Muhammad Ali standing there with him. Another reconciliation, something that we might not have ever thought of doing, but through his language and through his helping us reconcile who we are and to begin to feel whole, helped us understand our responsibility. I'm almost done. Congressman Keith Ellison. Everyone know Congressman Keith? He's a follower of W.D. Muhammad. He attends Masjid An-Nur in Minneapolis, Minnesota. And I put this picture up because not only were we reconciled with race, not only reconciled with religion, not only reconciled with our civic duty, right? We were also reconciled in terms of politics. Where once Malcolm would refuse, right, quite loudly in public, in terms of the civil rights movement and Martin Luther King, right, that we weren't supposed to be in politics. What's the point? Why be in politics, right? We know that Malcolm, if you study Malcolm, he moved more toward Martin's ideas in terms of making change through policy, making change through laws, right? And so eventually W.D. Muhammad also encouraged us to go into politics, to go into public service. I always like that term better than politics, public service, right? To go into public service. And here's a picture of Keith Ellison, a Muslim, black Muslim, African-American Muslim, Bernie Sanders, from the state I live in, Vermont, and Imam Talib Sharif. Imam Talib Sharif is the imam of the nation's mosque in Washington, D.C. And they're actually holding a forum in the mosque in Washington, D.C., which was the third, I believe, mosque in the Nation of Islam in Washington, D.C. Maybe the third established.
The first one built from the ground up.
The first one built from the ground up. We have a pioneer, so I get it. Why am I saying this? Because all of these things resonate with us. All of these things resonate with us. I see the community, the Muslim community, not just the African American community, but the Muslim community. In the military, in politics, doing interfaith dialogue, right? Living out the legacy of W.D. Muhammad. The Muslim community, not the African American community, the Muslim community, but the Muslim community in general. When I go to ISNA conferences or ICMA conferences, when I open up the Message magazine, when I open up Islamic Horizons, right? What I see being done as efforts to situate ourselves into the fabric of this country is really all the work of W.D. Muhammad. Of course, we're all doing the work now, but he opened up in many, many ways the opportunities for us to do this, to reconcile ourselves with who we are as Muslims, who we are culturally, who we are as Americans. And then finally, I have a picture of a dear friend of ours, say ours, myself and Sheikh Mendes, Suleiman Hamed. Imam Suleiman Hamed leads groups of pilgrims on the Hajj every year. He and his wife, Shahida Sharif, have a company called Hajj Pros. I guess this is a plug for them. I'll have to call them and tell them I gave them a...
Just share it with
them. Okay. That ultimately is the achievement, right? The great achievement that we can go to Hajj and see people of all races. We can go to Hajj, not only see people of different races, but also become very aware of our own distinctiveness. So again, in the Hajj, the work of W.D. Muhammad was to show us always, over many, many decades, you belong to a big, beautiful, wonderful community of Muslims around the world, but you also have your own distinct life. And so his work was to get us to feel comfortable in that distinctive life, that distinctive expression, but seeing it within the whole, seeing it within the human community. One of the things I want to say about Suleiman, the one carrying this flag, right? You know, I mentioned the flag a couple of times, but the flag that the Nation of Islam had was freedom, justice, and equality. And then we have the American flag, right? But this flag that W.D. Muhammad made for his community has a Quran that's open, right? And the light is coming out of the Quran, right? And some of you may have seen it, that I can maybe perhaps find another picture, but it has La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah in the Quran, right? So again, just to reiterate, even from the very beginning, the Quran and the life of W.D. Muhammad was central. And without the Quran, his work in his life and his legacy could not be what it is. So it wasn't just W.D. Muhammad working within his own mind and his own spirit and his own soul, but it was all of that being guided by God's word, guided by the Quran. So I put this picture up to end with, so that we can understand that the life and the legacy of W.D. Muhammad really is the Quran. It's the work that the Quran produces in the human soul, the urges that are produced by devotion to God's word in the human soul and in the human life, the interest that emerges when one begins to read the Quran and see what God expects of us as human beings. That's the work of W.D. Muhammad. I like this picture because not only is he holding the Quran, but he's among the stars. He's among the stars. among the heavens. And that's where we all are, among the heavens. We're in the heavens when we're reconciled with ourselves, when we're reconciled with others. And the only way that we can do that is when we reconcile ourselves with the one who created us all, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I think that's it. I think I'm going to stop right there.
Title slide and the voice quote and Sister Claire.
Yes. Any questions? Any comments? Yes. So the question was, there any influence from the Ahmadiyya movement on the Nation of Islam? Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Absolutely. This is not a time for a big conversation about the Ahmadiyya. But their missionary work alone, the way that they were making da'wah. Remember, there were Muslims here when they got here, but very quiet, very isolated, very isolated. But they came with a mission to propagate Islam when really no one else was doing that. And so their missionary work got into the spirit, right, of the African American Muslim, of the Nation of Islam, the members of the Nation of Islam. So that's why even to this day, you see them standing out on the corner with bow ties and suits, with their Muhammad Speaks, right, and their bean pies, and sometimes you'll see some fruit that they sell, right? I got some Muhammad Speaks, I think, a long time ago, during mountains, but the final call, right? Right? You'll see them going into the neighborhoods, right? You'll see them making da'wah. You'll see them having a very public presence. Right? So that's one of the things that influenced.
Did that linger?
It did. I would say that da'wah tends to be an important part of the African American Muslim ethos. Da'wah. Partly because we see ourselves in a, as W.D. Muhammad once called us, against signification, we were Negroes, we were Black Muslims, we were African American Muslims, we were Afro American, so many different names. He actually said we should call ourselves Bilalian. At one point he said, you're Bilalian.
I was going to ask about that. So was that an official name ever, or was that an identity?
That was a name.
Of the organization?
No, not of the organization, but a name that he encouraged his community to embrace.
Right?
All African Americans. That's right. That's
because,
right.
Because everybody has a national identity.
Yes.
They're Italian, but they're Jewish, or they're Arab, or whatever. But so what are you? You're a Negro. What's a Negro? Where's a Negro land?
Right.
There's no such place.
Right.
So he said, well, use the name that in our lineage. An African was a Muslim, and his name was Allah.
Yes.
He was the first one to call people to this great religion.
Absolutely. Right?
How could you be any greater than that?
Absolutely.
That's the best name for you to call yourself Allah.
Absolutely. So he said, right, that Bilal called the people to the religion. Right. So where I was wanting to go was the reason I mentioned Bilal and this other signification was that, yes, that missionary work, that calling people to Allah, calling people to the religion, really began with Bilal. He's the first Mu'adhin. He was calling the people to prayer, calling the people to God's oneness, calling the people to Muhammad, calling the people to success. right? And so yes, I think that there were theological lingerings as well in the Nation of Islam. But I would say that most of the things in the Nation of Islam that we as Muslims now may find troubling theologically were also part of Christian life, Christian tradition, right? Lineage that also was present in the religious thought and religiosity perhaps of the African American Muslim. Question? Yes.
Is there anything he's carrying on his, does he have any offspring that are carrying on his legacy?
Yeah, he has children. He has a number of children who all helped him in his ministry. One was with us last night at Princeton and lives in the area, Layla Muhammad, his daughter, who is doing tremendous work. In continuing her father's work of reconciling the races and reconciling religion. It's her passion and her love to do that. He has the mosque cares, his ministry, where his intellectual property and other things are available, is run, overseen by his son Wallace Muhammad II. But to give an answer that I feel would be satisfactory to him, I would have to say his entire community, or his offspring. I am his offspring. And I hope that I, among many others, continue his work and continue his legacy. Yes.
Well, one of the things that I wanted to mention that a lot of people don't seem to be aware of is the program, what Imam W.D. Muhammad did when he was sending the students to Syria to study. And a lot of people are so not Muslim and otherwise are not aware of it. I'm working on a film about this, but the piece is about them being in Syria,
yes,
and studying with the Grand Mufti. Were you one of the students? Were you Imam Mendes?
No, I wasn't, but I've met students there.
Right, like Mansour and Suleiman and all.
So I wanted to, and that's the reason why the one other thing I wanted to say about Suleiman I didn't, in terms of reconciling, because this is really important. Thank you. Thank you so much. Mm-hmm. That for many, many years, despite the deep love and regard for W.D. Muhammad from Muslims in America, there was always this sense that we quite weren't learned enough. We didn't quite have Islam as we should. Right? That we weren't quite Muslim enough because we weren't Hanafi or Malik, Shafi'i or Hanbali, right? That we weren't speaking Arabic fluently, right? All of the critiques and criticisms, right? And I never think that W.D. Muhammad was concerned about that. What he was concerned about was his community deepening their relationship with the Islamic tradition, right? Allowing for that to begin helping to shape what he had already formed and fashioned among his students. And so for many years, W.D. Muhammad would arrange for students from the community, young and old, to travel throughout the Muslim world to study the Islamic tradition, then to come back and to share that in the community, right? To help the community grow in Islam. So he sent students to Malaysia. He sent them to Malaysia. He sent students to Turkey. He sent students, where else?
Syria.
To Syria. I was, any other places? Syria tends to be the last part of his life. So in 99 was the first year, I believe. And then throughout the end of his life, students were going to Syria and Damascus, and they were studying at the Abu Nur Institute with Sheikh Ahmed Kuftar, who W.D. Muhammad said of him was his teacher, was his brother in faith, his kindred spirit, Sheikh Ahmed Kuftar. So I wanted to show Suleiman, because Suleiman was one of those students. He and his wife Shahida Sharif were students for 5 years in Syria, in Damascus. He speaks Arabic fluently, right? He's connected deeply to the tradition, right? Mansour Sabri, others. There's so many who have gone to study in Syria and now have come back and are leaders in our community and beginning to help us move even further into the Islamic tradition. The other thing about this picture is that it shows great independence. And that's what W.D. Muhammad wanted for his community, was an independent mind, to feel that we didn't have to be someone else to feel Muslim. We didn't have to look like someone else, dress like someone else. We didn't have to take on a subtle accent when we spoke. That we could be who we are and still be fully contributing to Muslim life in America. So this picture speaks a lot about that as well. So yes, thank you. I think that's an important thing as well to mention, this kind of reconciling his followers with the Islamic tradition, that's happening and continues to happen. Yes.
So this might be a little bit of a silly question, but how was his relationship with Minister Louis Farrakhan? Did they have like separate ideological leanings or?
Yeah.
I'm just curious.
Very good question. They had separate ideological leanings. Yes, yes. But W.D. Muhammad always saw Minister Farrakhan as his brother. Always saw him as his brother. Right? And we should see him as our brother. Minister Farrakhan is doing a tremendous work in the African American community. Right? A community that really is calling for us to be involved in. It's calling for us. The African American community needs us to be there. Not necessarily to convert them, but to serve them. Really. And so Minister Farrakhan is doing that. In 1975, Minister Farrakhan, Louis Farrakhan, in the transition, was with Wallace Muhammad. 3 years later, he decided to break away and to reform the Nation of Islam. And so in 1978, while W.D. Muhammad was leading the Nation of Islam, right, into the world community of Al-Islam in the West, right, Minister Farrakhan was starting anew A-N-E-W, not A. He started again the Nation of Islam. There was tremendous tension there, and these ideas were different. Even now, if you look at the back of Final Call, there's things that are troubling theologically for us, right? Not what they're doing socially, but theologically troubling. Right? But we find that by 2000, I believe at least 2002, they reconciled with each other. In fact, there was a gathering of the Nation of Islam and W.D. Muhammad's community, right? And there's a picture. You can find it online, of the two of them hugging each other. Right? Symbolic that we're brothers, even despite our differences. Right? We come from the same womb. We come from the same mother. We come from the same experience. We come from the same shared lived reality. of being black in America. So it's an important relationship. They reconcile with each other, their differences, right? And we've always been encouraged, followers of W.D. Muhammad, to even when I'm in my car and I see one of the brothers selling a newspaper, I buy it. Right? I buy the bean pie. Except I go to my mosque where I get better bean pies. At the mosque I go to get better bean pies. But we should do a documentary on bean pies.
There is one.
Is there one?
There's a documentary that's already been done. Google.
Oh wow, really? Right. It's the every bean one in here had a bean pie? Okay, alright. So we're in Jersey. I should know that. And bean soup. And carrot pie. That too, right? And cheese pie, right? Carrot cake, I mean. Yes. Oh yes sir. And then I'll come to you. Yes sir.
Again,
I
just said thank you very much for the knowledge and
my pleasure. Thank you.
I guess this might be another silly question. Do you know what size is the community of Mr. Farrakhan?
Mr. Farrakhan? The last I read was less than 50,000. It's not a large community by any means. It never really has been, but usually the one with the loudest voice gets all the attention. Yeah, he got the Million Man March back in 1994, 1995. Yeah, so his voice is powerful, right? What he's saying, even what the language of the Nation of Islam resonates with the black community, right? The truths that they speak resonate. Right? They probably resonate with us in this room too. We just a little more. We have to do the dance. Gotta be a little more cautious. There was a question here, and then I'll let you manage it.
We'll just take one more question, and if anyone else wants to speak with Imam Khalil after we close the dua, I'll ask you to make a closing dua. You're welcome to do that, but you know people have to go home, and you know we have to be here for Fajr, and he has to catch a plane in the morning, you know, with afternoon, so. I think one more question. You can choose whatever you like.
Sure. He was holding his hand.
Just a quick question. I'm interested in understanding what factors influenced the Imam to take a stance against the Nation of Islam's beliefs. What made him reform it? My understanding is it was in the 60s when he was in prison, he read Quran and that changed it. Was that the only factor? Or were there other personalities that influenced him or anything else?
It's a great question. I would say that even prior to his being imprisoned in Minnesota, he was in Minnesota, Sandstone, Minnesota, where he, Sheikh Mendes, you know that he speaks often about his cellmate was a Native American. And that's where he developed this deep love for the Native American people. In Sandstone, Minnesota. Sandstone Correctional Facility, it was called. It was prior to his time in prison that he began to have differences with his father. We know that he was excommunicated at least 3 times from the Nation of Islam, meaning he was kicked out, right? Because this young Wallace, all the other ministers would say about this young Wallace, he's not preaching what you're preaching. In fact, I would encourage you to find a 1958 or 1959 audio recording when he was the minister in Philadelphia. Malcolm comes to speak in Philadelphia and he introduces Wallace. And in 1959, you hear Wallace stand up and recite Al-Fatiha in Arabic and give his own tafsir, his own translation of Al-Fatiha in 1959. So he was already reading the Quran for many years. Right? In fact, the language, the mystery around W.D. Muhammad was that he was the chosen one.
Right.
That he was the special child. Right? that he was supposed, he was the seventh son, right? The seventh child. He was supposed to be the one to lead the nation of Islam further than what his father could do. So there's always this mystery around him, and this sense we hear from his friends and his longtime companions that grew up with him, that he always had a different mind. He always had this love for religion. But it was, he oftentimes says, that it was his reading of not only the Quran, but the Bible when he was in prison, and his comparing the two, right? That's why his depth of wisdom and is that he can look at the Quran and he can find the commonalities in scripture in the Bible, right? And he can speak to the sensibilities of the American public because he's familiar with these two texts and he can find where they intersect, right? But there were some others who would have conversations with him. There were a number of others. Teachers like Jamil Diab, who his father brought to teach Arabic in the nation, the University of Islam, and others, Mahmoud Ayoub. We're inviting Mahmoud Abdul-Rauf to Dartmouth next week, and it's on my brain. Mahmoud Ayoub, who was also teaching in Philadelphia at Temple University. His conversations with W.D. Muhammad. There are others, but his daughter Layla told me just last night, because I asked the question, like, where's all the imam's books? Like, can I get access to his library? I just want to read what he was reading. And she said, Khalil, don't worry about that. Read everything you can, because that's what daddy did. Just read. She said that I was in school in college and I'd bring home my biology book, and when it was time for me to do homework, I'd be like, where's my book? Daddy had it. Yeah, so that's what she told me. Daddy had it, right? So he read a lot, right? He had a curious mind. And he wasn't just reading the Quran and the life of the Prophet, right? He was reading all kinds of books. He was what some call an autodidact, right? He was a self-taught scholar, right? He was a Renaissance man of sorts. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you so much. Alhamdulillah, we're going to ask you now, Khalil, to close us with a dua, with a supplication. Thank you all so much for staying to the end. I'm sure you found this as edifying as I did. We hope you come back and visit us, anytime you're in the area. And thank you so much, Jazakallah Khair, for sharing so much knowledge and wisdom and experience with us.
ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب الفاتحة all together بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. Thank you again. Assalamu alaikum.